I got my game for game review. Two grandmasters in the game. And I sure would like for you to view. We're recording now, what do you say? Game review. Game review. Welcome back to Game Review. My name is Caleb Denby, and today we're going to be looking at a game between Vladimir Kramnik and Fabiano Caruana. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In the game, they played e4, e5, knight f3, knight f6, knight takes e5, d6, knight f3, knight takes e4. And we are squarely in the Petrov defense, or the Russian game, as European players might know it. Of course, this is an opening that Fabiano has been playing for a couple years now with pretty great success. It was one of the main reasons he did so well in the 2018 candidates. He won a couple key games with this Petrov defense, and this was one of them. It turns out it's a pretty tough nut to crack. He's really brought this back into popularity, kind of single-handedly. It wasn't really being played too much at the top level. I mean, it saw some play, but mostly grandmasters were, you know, playing Berlins every game. But Fabi employed the Petrov. Here, white has a lot of moves. Knight c3, for example. d3 is playable. d4 is playable. White chose the move queen e2 in this game, which is kind of less testing. Of course, this pins the knight to the king, and so it is very sensible for black to play queen e7, unpinning and putting pressure along the e-file as well. Now white plays knight c3. We see takes, takes, queen takes e2. Bishop takes e2, and knight c6. So now we have this interesting structure where white has doubled pawns on the queen side, but in return, he's already opened up this bishop kind of with tempo. So white has a slight lead in both development, and he's going to have a lead in space as well. That lead in space is going to come from this pawn coming to c4, when it's just a little bit tough for black to push this pawn to d5 to free up this bishop along this diagonal. The game continued with bishop e3, black develops with bishop e7, white queenside castles, and black actually castles kingside. And now, as the queens are off the board, probably neither side is going to be going for, you know, some pawn storm into a checkmate. Instead, what we'll see is with kings on opposite sides of the board, pawn storms still do happen, but it's not really with the idea of checkmating the opponent's king. It's very difficult to do that without the queens. Rook he1 was played in the game, just bringing a rook to the center of the board. Bishop f6 was Fabi's choice, getting this bishop off this file and putting pressure on the kind of fractured structure of white's queenside. White plays knight d2, freeing up this diagonal for this bishop, so eyeing this e4 square when this bishop might be a little bit trapped. Rook e8 from black is very sensible. One open file on the board, gotta control it. Bishop f3. Now, similarly, puts pressure on black's queen side, as black's bishop does to white. Knight e5 is black's choice, hitting this bishop. After bishop f4, though, black actually isn't too interested in taking off this light-squared bishop. And the reason for that is, well, they're better at chess, and so they understand these things, even if I don't. But the reason is, of course, checkmate. So don't get checkmated. Instead, we see king f8. Now, this rook is defended, he won't get checkmated, so bishop d5. Now c6 hits the bishop again, and this bishop comes back to b3. And this little maneuver is really interesting. Later on in the game, we'll see this actually become a pretty huge problem for white. On b3, the bishop looks, you know, well-placed, it's defended by these pawns, it's difficult to kind of attack, you're not really gonna find any way to attack this bishop too much with the knight. Things like knight d7 to c5 just don't really make so much sense here. So the bishop's safe, it's kind of tucked away on b3, but the problem is it's a little bit actually out of play, as we'll see later on. From this diagonal, you do control some squares, but you'll see Fabi starts to play on the king's side of the board, where this bishop is just a little bit stranded. You know, it's not so easy to get this bishop back into play over here. And so bishop f5 is Fabi's choice at first, just getting developed. Now, after h3, I'll let you try and find Fabi's next move. It's not a winning tactic or anything, but it does divert the play away from this bishop and towards the king's side of the board, where white is a little bit understaffed, a little bit undermanned on the king's side, with just this bishop and knight to look after it. Meanwhile, all of these pieces well-placed. Of course, the move I'm talking about is g5. g5 hits this bishop, the bishop drops back to h2, and now simply king g7. We'll see white plays c4, and now g4. And Fabi has very clearly stated his intentions here. He wants to create weaknesses on the king side and try and win some material over here, try and get at these pawns stuck on this second rank. Meanwhile, though, white has plenty of play of his own. He's looking at this backwards d pawn. This is white's big idea in the opening. You know, he uses this extra c pawn to cramp the black pawn, keep it from pushing to d5, and he's going to hope to break through and capture this d6 pawn. In the game, white went for knight e4. And now Fabi makes a very interesting decision. There's, of course, a lot of pressure on this d6 pawn, so Fabi simply takes off this knight with bishop takes e4, rook takes e4, and now he comes in with bishop g5 check, hitting the king. The king steps to b1, and now Fabi actually takes on h3. We see not g takes h3, which is maybe what should have been played, but c5 from white. And so what has happened here, I went through those last few moves pretty quickly, but Fabi gives up his light squared bishop, and in return, he gains some time to play this move, g takes h3, and now finally break through with a move like f5. So he traded off this bishop for some extra time to quicken his play on the queen's side. So with f5 and g takes h3, you know, this rook has been drawn to the e4 square, and the f5 square has been cleared by the trade on e4. So Fabi gains this time, and his pawns are starting to push up the board. And in fact, this turns out to be very, very good for Fabiano here. And so the white rook is going to have to move. The white rook comes all the way over to b4, and Fabi takes this chance to take on g2. And now we see that black is starting to have a very, very dangerous pawn. I also wanted to mention, Fabi gave up a light squared bishop. And if you look at the light squared bishop for white, usually in these high level games, the danger in giving up one of your bishops is your opponent's bishop starts to become a lot more powerful because you have no bishop to oppose it. We call it the unopposed bishop. In this case, though, this bishop kind is just not so impressive. You know, it's stuck on this one diagonal, and it can't find its way back into the game. So you see Fabi playing against this bishop in this game. This is kind of the theme so far. Of course, by taking on g2, Fabi allows this rook to get in to b7, but he's not afraid. He simply tucks the king away on h8. Now we see c takes d6, and both sides have very, very scary pawns. Black continued with knight f3, hitting the bishop and guarding the queening square. And here, black actually played very accurately with bishop a4, just totally giving up the bishop on h2. In return, he's going to take off this c6 pawn and get this pawn even closer to queening. Black, of course, takes the material. And now we see bishop takes c6, as expected. And Fabi plays the correct move here somehow, which is rook ad8. Allowing bishop takes e8, if that's what white wants. Actually, though, bishop takes e8 isn't so good for white. If you capture, black will simply recapture. Now, if we take a quick look at the position, black is going to keep this g-pawn, and black is also going to have a very nice blockade on the d8 square. It's going to be tough to break that blockade. You can imagine, of course, something like, we'll say rook g1, but now you get met with knight f3. You can't take the pawn because rook e1 is mate, so you probably have to play something like d7. Now something like rook d8 or rook g8 might come. And after rook g1, something like bishop e7. And black is keeping an eye on this d8 pawn, and he's also going to be threatening to queen shortly. So instead of taking the material, white simply pushes to d7. This rook jumps into the e2 square, and white takes off this g2 pawn before any of that can happen. Now, black, of course, captures on f2, very sensible, taking more material. Bishop back to c6 helps support this pawn. We see knight g4 from black, getting the knight back into the game. Rook takes a7. This knight comes to e3 now. Rook g1, and then Fabi finally slips. Turns out the best move here, you know, which both sides have actually been playing kind of astoundingly accurately so far for such a crazy position. It turns out black should have taken on c2, hitting this bishop on c6 in return for the bishop on g5. And after a move like bishop a4, you can simply drop this rook back to f2, and now you're threatening a checkmate. Instead, though, Fabi played a little bit more simply defended his bishop on h6. Unfortunately, this allows white some time to play rook c7, and now already white is making threats of a rook c8 when rook g5 is threatened to remove the blockade of this d pawn. Fabi tried king g7 to get the king closer to the pawn, but now after a4, which is the best move, not rook c8, rook c8 also would have been okay. We see king f7 really trying to get to this d8 square, but now bishop b5 from white, king e7 from black. Fabi just playing very naturally, getting the king to the pawn. Now a5 comes up the board. White is pushing a second pawn forward. This is kind of terrifying. In return, Fabi is playing with his pieces. He plays rook f4, and after c3, preventing rook b4, now Fabi finally slips up again. Thus far, black has been better, and then white kind of equalized with this rook c7 idea. Now Fabi has to actually play pretty accurately here. You can play a move like knight d5 to displace this rook, or a move like rook g4 to displace this rook. After something like rook h1, now suddenly things like f4 can start coming on the board, things like bishop f4, getting rid of this rook, and black can kind of on for a little bit. Instead though, Fabi tried king d6, and it turns out the move rook c6 check is actually quite good for white. You can't take this pawn due to the discovery of rook takes h6 and rook takes g5, so king e7 is forced, and now a6 would be coming on the board, and it's very difficult to stop this pawn. Rook takes d7 gets met with rook c8, and now you cannot move this rook away, or else rook e8 will pick up your knight. Very complicated tactics. Instead though, white missed this as well and played rook b7. Now rook g4 from Fabi, rook e1 from white, f4, guards this knight, gets this pawn closer to queening, a6, and now h5, both sides running two pawns up the board, a7 from white, rook a8 tries to stop this pawn, b4 from white, more pawns coming up the board, now h4, we see c4, h3, c5 check, king e5, now rook b8, and believe it or not, this is the last move that Stockfish calls a mistake, quote-unquote, where black is equalized again. Thus far, white was slightly better. Turns out the move bishop c6 is the only way to try to prove an advantage. And now after h2, things get very, very crazy with rook h1, rook g1, king b2, and somehow, some way, white is stopping both of these pawns for the moment. I know, it's kind of ridiculous chess. No way for the players to really see all of this, but instead rook b8 actually allows black to take on a7, and now the bishop will guard the d7 pawn from queening. So rook g8 was played. Of course, we do need this bishop, so bishop f6 is the move, and now after d8 queen, we take this guy, and we play not rook takes bishop, but instead rook takes rook, taking advantage of this pin. Now bishop f6 from Fabi, rook g6, rook b7 picks up this pawn. See bishop e2, rook takes b4, king a2, now knight c2 attacks this rook and starts to threaten some checkmates. Rook c1 from white, knight d4 from black, now bishop d3 from white. And at this point in the game, I think both players were kind of in some severe time pressure, and so they're just trying to find some way to make sense of the position. Fabi's approach actually turned out to be going after this king a little bit with these moves like knight c2 and now rook a4 to come, and using these threats on the king, he's trying to divert the white pieces away from guarding these pawns quite so vigilantly, and then he will use them to try to win. So rook a4 check comes on the board, as I said, now king b1, and once again knight b3, we see Fabi trying to make use of these pieces to attack this white king. Of course, rook a1 is now a threat, so we see rook e1 check, and actually king d5 from white. You cannot take this bishop due to rook a1 and rook takes e1, so king c2 is played. Now this is met with knight d4 check, king back to b1, and now knight f3 hits this rook and threatens to play rook a1. And it turns out this is actually an unstoppable threat in this case. If you move the rook up to a square like e8, Now, black has achieved his goal. He's diverted the white pieces away from the first, and h2 wins the game. If you play the move played in the game, rook d1, well, you still end up losing the rook to the game continuation. So it turns out rook takes f6 was required. And now after knight takes e1, you have some position here where black is up a pawn and trying somehow to win the game. Instead, though, rook d1, and the game continuation is correct. Rook a1, check, king c2. Now rook takes d1, king takes, or not king takes d1, because if king takes d1, once again, h2, and you cannot stop this pawn after bishop h4. And so Fabi is simply winning the game after rook takes d1. Bishop a6 was white's try, but now simply rook d2 check, bishop b2 check, king takes c5, and now the rest is history. Black is simply up a piece and a couple pawns. And after f2, Vladimir Kramnik resigned. And this is a very, very complex game, and it's one of the key games that led Fabi to go on and challenge Magnus for the World Championship. Thank you very much for joining me today on Game Review. My name is Caleb Denby, and I will see you next time.